Hi everyone, and welcome to the Clean Energy Regulator and to our webinar this morning, which is on audit evidence. I'd like to start by acknowledging the traditional owners of the many lands from which we are dialing in from today and acknowledge their continuing connection to land, sea and culture. I'd like to pay my respects to the elders past, present and emerging and extend those respects to any Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander people who are joining us today. My colleagues and I are dialing in from Canberra today, which is located on Ngunnawal and Ngambri country, where traditional owners have been living and caring for country for at least 20,000 years. If you want to move on to the housekeeping slide, thanks, Julian. As Peter has already mentioned, we do have a bit of a housekeeping today. But first of all, Julian Bishop is the audit expert who is presenting today. He is contracted to the Clean Energy Regulator as an auditor, inspector and consultant. Our webinar today is going to run for about 40 minutes, and there's going to be time at the end of the presentation for questions and answers. As Peter has also mentioned, we are recording this webinar and we will be publishing it, including the transcript, on our website in the coming weeks. We ask that you keep your microphones muted during the webinar and your cameras off. If you want to ask a question during the webinar, you may unmute your microphone and ask your question. However, we're encouraging people to ask questions by typing them into the chat box, and we'll answer these and any other questions you have in the Q&A session at the end of the main presentation. And you can open the chat box using the button that appears in the top right corner of your screen. When you open the chat box, it'll appear on the right side of your screen. At the bottom of it is a text box where you can type in questions and comments. And so now I'll hand over to Julian so that he can take us through the session.
Thank you. Thank you, Barbara. And so welcome everyone to this session on audit evidence. And I know a number of people that are on the call, so it'd be good just to just step through some of the various concepts that we see as being some of the areas where more frequently we see some of the areas where there's question marks around the level of evidence that's been obtained. I'd like to just step through the standards and just make sure that we are clear what the standards require around audit evidence. But I appreciate that you know, a number of you are quite familiar with the auditing standards and the concepts, so we won't spend too much time just going through some of the technicalities, but it's important, I think, that we just have some good sort of foundational understanding of what is required. And I think as Barbara said, we'll just pick up any comments that you might put into the chat as we go through. We'll pick them up at the end and just answer those questions right at the end. So let's move on to, you know, what we might see as being some of the more common issues that, you know, we see around around audit evidence. You know, clearly, audit evidence is a fundamental part of the audit process. You know, it's where the auditor spends most of their time spends most of their time and effort. So just to pick up on a few points that you can see that I've just highlighted on the slide. Now, one thing that we'll just continue to have as a theme as we go through is just around having the right mindset around audit evidence. Now, it's not an exercise of just trying to find evidence to corroborate, you know, what we're being asked to give an opinion on. You know, we need to take an unbiased approach to, you know, seeking out evidence that might be inconsistent or disagree. And when we're selecting the procedures to perform, that, you know, it's important that it isn't seen, as I say, just to be an exercise of just confirming what it is that we're giving our opinion on. The overall stand back I've just highlighted as well, which really, again, is just around, you know, we can focus our audit work and our audit effort and evidence on certain risks. You know, standing back at the end and just seeing, does it all hang together? Does it all make sense? What's the big picture? We'll talk a bit more about that as we go through. And that all sort of links into the final point also that I've highlighted, which again emphasizes this mindset is, this is all around just trying to make sure that we are having a healthy evaluation of all evidence that's presented to us, whether it's inconsistent, whether it corroborates, whether it's indication of bias. You know, that's the healthy mindset that I think that we need to try and continue to have, when we're looking at audit evidence. So if I just have a look at some of the questions, and I've just thrown some random questions up there on the slide. So those are going to be questions that we will look to try and focus our attention on. And obviously the first one, how much evidence is enough, is clearly one of the foundational questions in all of this. So, whilst there's a lot of judgment involved in that, we'll try and make sure that there's a good understanding of what the principles are that we need to apply. So we'll come back to these questions a little later. So if we just move into some of the relevant technical concepts that I'd just like to make sure that we've all got a good understanding of. So what is it that we mean when we say audit evidence? What really does that term mean? So if we look at what we've got, as we might sort of extract from the technical literature, it's all information that you're using, whether it's information that's being provided in accounting records, documentary evidence, or from any other source that we might seek that evidence, whether it's from a technical expert's report, whether it's benchmark data across the industry, that all constitutes audit evidence. So what's in the grey box there, you'll see just as examples, a variety of different examples of what we should see when we're talking about this concept of audit evidence. And what's relevant also is how have we arrived at this audit evidence. So we'll talk a lot later about the reliability of evidence. So those procedures that you can see, whether it's analytical procedures, down through to re-performance, they're all the different ways in which the auditor can perform procedures. And it's quite relevant to understand the source of the evidence and how we've arrived at that in helping us to really understand how much does that contribute towards enough evidence. And just highlighting another point that we'll come back to as we go through about inquiry, it's the auditing standards would say ordinarily does not provide sufficient evidence on its own. So let's keep that in mind as one of the key concepts as we step through. So a couple of the standards that I just really wanted to focus on, in terms of what is it that they're telling us around this topic of audit evidence. So we've got ASA 500 on audit evidence and the reporting standard 705. Now, I appreciate these are auditing standards and not ASAEs, but really they provide the depth of guidance that is necessary to supplement performing these audit engagements. I've highlighted some points that are on there from the audit evidence standard. The objective, as we all would appreciate, is just to obtain sufficient appropriate evidence to be able to draw reasonable conclusions. That's what it's saying is the whole purpose of gathering audit evidence. And when we look at what does that really mean and how can we sort of translate that into something more objective, it's going on to say, look, we're trying to reduce the risk of giving a wrong opinion to a low level. So those are the technical concepts. Now, I'm sure for people who've been involved in the audit space for a long time, that's nothing new. That's well understood. But it's really helpful just to keep reminding ourselves, what is it that we are trying to achieve when we're gathering our audit evidence? And then just moving on to towards the end of the session, we'll just talk about the implications of audit evidence on our audit opinion from ASA 705. So whether we issue an unqualified opinion, whether it's qualified, adverse or disclaimer, is all relevant in the context of how much evidence have we gathered and what has that evidence told us. So if we move on to just a number of the concepts around audit evidence that I've just quickly stepped through, just so that we can just make sure that we understand what they really mean and how they might be relevant and where issues might arise when we're talking about each of these concepts. So the first one around sufficiency, so that's the language that's used, and it really is all around the quantity of evidence, how much in terms of the quantity. But I think it's important for us to appreciate what that really means in terms of, well, how do we assess quantity of evidence? And it's really, you know, twofold, as you can see, where it's around what of your level of risk that you've assessed. Have you said that this is a low risk area, high risk area, significant risk area, whatever, you know, your the methodologies that you use and the language that you use, that's driving the quantity of audit evidence that we need to be obtaining. But really relevant to that is just, you know, this concept of the quality of audit evidence. So when we talk about the quality of audit evidence, that again is sort of drilled down to these two concepts around relevance and reliability. And as you can see, you know, on the slide, the point there about not all audit evidence is of the same quality. And, you know, we'll step through a little bit more about when we're talking about reliability of evidence. What does that really mean? And how do I, you know, try and interpret that in different situations? And how does that really influence how much evidence that I'm gathering? So if we just have a look at the, you know, the relevance of information. So, you know, this, you know, logically is just around connecting the evidence that you're gathering with what you're trying to achieve from your audit procedure. You know, that's basically, you know, what it really means. But I think, you know, that can be an easy concept to get a head around. But often when we look at the audit evidence that we're gathering and the procedures that we're performing, it doesn't always really achieve the objective of what we're trying to be getting at. So the example that you can see there on the slide, just around, you know, we need to understand the control environment. An audit procedure might be, well, let me have an inquiry with the agent just to try and get some understanding. And you think, well, really, is that achieving the purpose of demonstrating that you've got an understanding? So just trying to link what the objective is that you're really trying to achieve with what the underlying audit procedure is and the evidence that you're getting, and is it really relevant? Am I performing the right and relevant procedures? Probably that, you know, I think this is probably one of the most important topics of when we're talking about audit evidence is, you know, this concept of the reliability. And if we sort of drill down into, well, what does that really mean? The factors, you know, that we need to be thinking about is, you know, the source of that information. Where did it come from? And what are the implications of it coming from different sources? The nature of the audit evidence. And also, you know, highly important is the circumstances under which it's been obtained. So if you read the examples there that are presented on the slide, we need to, you know, not overlook this concept of, well, how reliable is it? And am I really reflecting that degree of reliability in the quantity of evidence that it's really providing to me? So it's a really important, you know, concept. And, you know, I think if we are seeing that we're not getting the reliable evidence that we are seeking, then we might need to think about performing extra procedures and think about if it is not reliable evidence, what other implications and impacts might it have on the remainder of the audit process. So we'll look at this a little further when we talk about the case study, but just keep in mind, you know, the reliability of the audit evidence is quite a fundamental aspect of what we're looking at here. Just moving on to the sources of information. You know, this isn't an absolute, you know, an accurate diagram necessarily. So don't place, you know, too much credibility on exactly where these circles are featuring. But in terms of, because there's, you know, there's far more other things to be thinking about as well, you know, when we're looking at the reliability of information than just the source. But, you know, as we need to be focused on, if it's client generated and it's internal, then there's a lot less reliability that's going to come from that. It's not saying that the information is not reliable. You know, we're not trying to say it's not reliable information and I cannot use it, but the degree to which I can use it as contributing towards sufficiency of evidence is lower. So that, you know, that you know, becomes important when we're looking at things like inquiry, when we're looking at things like stat decks, is really understanding the degree of reliability that we can place on different pieces of evidence and how that's then contributing towards our overall need for sufficiency. So we've talked about sufficient appropriate evidence, which is the term that we often see and refer to. And when we're looking at appropriateness of information, that's drilled down again into relevance and reliability. Some of the other aspects that are important for us to contemplate around, you know, the concepts of accessibility and availability and understandability of information. Again, you can see some examples there on the slide that can illustrate this point. And I'll talk about it a little bit later, but it's, you know, when, again, talking about just the mindset that we're applying and what the audit documentation is showing. Now, if there are concerns or if there are issues around just accessibility, then it's healthy for the audit file or the documentation to reflect those things. You know, if there's issues with understandability of the evidence, then, you know, it's not that our audit documentation needs to just show all the positive things and all the good things and all the things that are working in our favour. You know, we've always had the issue around how do we try and evidence a sceptical audit? You know, these can be areas where, you know, we shouldn't just sort of be downplaying some of the limitations that are affecting how we've conducted our audit, and that they are relevant in the audit process and the audit approach that we're taking. So if I move on to corroborative and inconsistent evidence, so, you know, I think, you know, corroborative evidence speaks for itself. You know, it's evidence that supports the assertions that are being made. And, you know, so that's fairly self-explanatory. Inconsistent evidence is the term that is used in the standards where, you know, things aren't necessarily in line with the assertions that are being made or the things that we're giving an opinion on. So just making sure that, you know, we are reflecting in our audit documentation any evidence of inconsistency. So, you know, it doesn't mean to say that if I've got some inconsistent evidence that there's necessarily an overall issue with the opinion that you might give, but we need to be making sure that we have thought about alternatives, inconsistencies in coming up with our overall conclusions. So I just wanted to step through, you know, what do we do with our audit evidence? You know, when we've obtained the evidence, what is it that we are, how do we step through then using that evidence to forming our opinion? So obviously at the individual risk level, then we are assessing the evidence that we've obtained to against that risk. So that's done, you know, risk by risk. The stand back and the stepping back around the evaluate the overall evidence, I think, is an important step that's often, you know, can be overlooked. So I think having to just stand back and just take a big picture look at all of the, whether it's inconsistencies, whether it's misstatements, whether it's bias, all of those items that you only really get when you're sort of standing back and looking at the big picture is an important step. And, you know, that's, as I flowed into this, identify any evidence of intentional bias. And, you know, intentional bias, I guess, is the label that we would say for fraud. You know, there can be unintentional bias that we would say, you know, it's not fraud. But if there is any intentional bias, then that can lead into, you know, just the being the identification of fraud and the consequences of that. But that can only really come when we're looking at things at the big picture, at the overall level, and if necessary, flowing that back into our risk assessments. Now, I don't want to dwell too much on these. You know, we should all, I hope, be very familiar with the different options that we have for audit opinions. The extent to which audit evidence, you know, relates to this can be from the perspective of insufficient audit evidence to form a basis for your opinion, or the evidence shows that things are inconsistent or they're not right. So, you know, I think that both elements of those have implications for the appropriate opinion that we should give. So, and I'd like to think that everybody's very familiar with those that are on this call, so I don't want to spend time going through those. The point that I would point out, though, in the part B is we need to be careful that we're not communicating limitations and issues in the audit evidence gathering process through part B without really closing the loop and acknowledging why the opinion that we've given overall in part A still stands. It can be concerning where there's an unqualified opinion given, but when you're reading part B, there can be identification of limitations on the evidence gathering, whether it's availability of evidence or accessibility. You know, we need to make sure that those loops are closed, and it's not begging the question as to, you've acknowledged these limitations here, so why have you still given an unqualified opinion? So let me just go back to some of the questions that were on the slide that I showed at the first. And you know, the obvious fundamental one is, how much is enough? How much evidence do we need to gather? And I think, you know, we've stepped through these concepts, but I just really want to sort of reiterate, you know, there's a lot of judgment involved. There's no science about how much is enough, and it needs to be seen in the context of having enough evidence to reduce the risk of giving the wrong opinion to an acceptably low level. I appreciate that's subjective, that's judgmental, but that's really the test that we are looking to apply. So when we're looking at, well, how much do I need to gather at an individual risk level, then you know, we should be assessing different risks and assigning them different levels, whether you use a concept of base, elevated, significant, whether it's non-significant, significant, high, moderate, or low, whatever it is the label that's being applied. That is the driver of the quantity of audit evidence that we need to be gathering. So it's, you know, sometimes can be difficult when you look at the audit procedures and the audit evidence and just saying, well, what would you have done differently if it had been a significant risk compared to a non-significant risk? But we need to make sure that the audit evidence that we have gathered is responsive to the level of risk that we have assigned. And when we're trying to look at, well, how much evidence from a quantity perspective, again, as I've mentioned before, really drilling down into the quality of that evidence. All pieces of evidence aren't the same quality, and we need to be mindful of the source of evidence, the reliability of the evidence, the relevance of the evidence in helping us to determine what quality do we think that evidence is giving us, and how much is it contributing towards the quantity that we need to respond to the level of risk. So some more sort of detail and specific questions, again, which are really just reflecting back on those overall key principles. You know, if no documentation was prepared at the time, so what are the implications or consequences of that? So again, we really sort of going back to if documentary evidence or verbal evidence is provided at a later date than when things may have occurred. So there's examples of, where you're asking the question today about whether there was any evidence of ongoing monitoring and there was nothing documented at the time, but it's being verbally stated to you today, then, you know, there's question marks then about the reliability of that evidence. And when I say question marks, it doesn't mean to say that you can't use that evidence, but the degree to which it's contributing towards this overall concept of sufficiency and quantity of evidence needs to reflect how reliable is it and how much does it really contribute towards the overall quantity that I need. If we move on to, should I disclose any limitations in the audit evidence in part B? Hopefully I answered that question when we were just going through the previous slide, just around making sure that we're not undermining or bringing to question whether sufficient evidence has been obtained in support of our Part B overall opinion. So it doesn't mean to say that we shouldn't be disclosing any limitations. You know, the additional information can be very helpful, but it just needs to be understood in the context of the overall opinion that's been given. Can I rely solely on oral representations. Yeah, I think we've talked about this point, and obviously evidence gathering is a cumulative exercise, and it's often just not one piece of evidence that's contributing towards sufficiency. So inquiry is certainly a very healthy part of the accumulation of sufficient evidence, but keep in mind that the auditing standards say, in quote, inquiry alone ordinarily does not provide sufficient appropriate evidence. So it's certainly got its place, and it's a necessary piece of corroboration, but keep in mind that on its own, ordinarily, it is unlikely to give sufficient evidence. Can I rely on a stat deck? I think we've probably covered the concepts here around how reliable is that. And as I say, it's not suggesting that what's in the statutory declaration is factually incorrect, but the degree to which we can use it in this context of reliability contributing towards sufficient evidence needs to be contemplated. The circumstances point here, I think, is quite important. Now, often some of these statutory declarations can be created purely for audit purposes. So we need to be mindful of that and contemplate that in the context of how reliable is that in contributing evidence when it might have been done at a much later date and it might have been done for audit purposes. So that was a run through of the some of the technical aspects that I wanted to touch on. Let's just move in for the next 10 minutes before we move into question time, just on a couple of case studies. So I've used the first case study being HIR example, and just picked out three different risks. Now, these are just a selection of risks, as opposed to suggesting that these are all risks by any means. They're just a selection just to try and help to illustrate the application of some of those concepts and what that means in terms of sufficient appropriate audit evidence. So if we look at the first one in terms of has suppression activity occurred, and maybe you've assessed a medium risk to that. These are all arbitrary. These aren't in any way, based on anything other than just an arbitrary allocation for the purpose of these case studies. So I put down just a selection also of different types of audit procedures and where audit evidence might come from, whether that's from a stat deck, whether it's from inquiry, whether it's from observing on a site visit, or whether it's been inspecting documents, reports, registers, etc. And as you can see, just in broad terms, and again, please don't take this as being absolute by any means, it's just trying to give some indications as to what may well be the appropriate contribution towards sufficient appropriate evidence. You've got things like inspection, re-performance, that are going to be at the higher end of the spectrum in terms of how much they're contributing. And especially if you're looking at if there are invoices that you can see from contractors, hire of equipment, etc., going back to the time when suppression activity was occurring. Those are good, reliable pieces of audit evidence. Whereas down the other end of the spectrum, you can see the contribution towards this sufficient evidence from a stat deck, which potentially, as I say, could be done for audit purposes at a much later date. We need to keep in context in terms of how much really is that contributing towards the sufficient appropriate evidence. So I'm not using the word reliance. It's not that we can't use that, or if we want to use the word rely on that, but the degree to which it's contributing sufficient evidence needs to be carefully considered in terms of the quality of that evidence and the reliability of that evidence. If I move on to the next point here on regrowth potential. So a lot of the same points are down here as far as the different types of procedures and some of the different issues that we might come across and how much they're contributing. We're focusing on the inspection heading there, where we might be looking at a report that's prepared by a management expert and the strength of evidence that this can provide. You know, it can be down to assessing the knowledge, skill, ability of the expert, which we know that we need to do. But, you know, if all those things are looking good, then the level of reliability of that information in contributing towards sufficient evidence could be quite high. I think it's really just, again, just keeping these concepts, keeping these principles in mind when we're looking at the nature of evidence that we're gathering in relation to the particular risk and the level of risk that we're assigning. I didn't put high risk on the previous slide here, but if we said the risk we are assigning is high, then we're going to need a greater quantity of evidence, which is more evidence, but more quality evidence. Moving on to the third risk, where we've got the ongoing monitoring, has there been ongoing monitoring? Just the extra point that I just wanted to pick out here. If you look down the lower end, the stat deck end, or even not necessarily a stat deck, just a less formal statement around, yes, there has been ongoing monitoring. You know, just questioning, well, you know, who's made that statement? When did they do it? What's the basis upon which they have made those statements? It's really sort of raising questions around the reliability being down the lower end of the spectrum, rather than the higher end of the spectrum. If we're looking at in the inspection headings there, if there are documented procedures for ongoing monitoring and there is evidence of performance of those procedures, then that's good, highly reliable evidence which is contributing towards being able to be satisfied around the ongoing monitoring. If I use just as an example, if you had a half yearly drive around a boundary fence just to check for integrity of that boundary fence, and there was a documented process that acknowledged that is the part of the ongoing monitoring, then that's good evidence in getting to understand that, that there is ongoing monitoring process around the testing the evidence of, well, is it actually happening? And if there is documentation that shows evidence of, who did the drive around, when did they do it, what did they find, as you can see, that is going to be contributing towards a much higher level of reliable evidence than if there's no documented evidence that's there that shows whether that six-monthly drive around actually did occur. So if we move on just to the last point here in the case studies, just around the forecasting. So this will bring in different types of audit procedures when we're looking at trying to get evidence over forecasts, when we can break it down into the model that's being used, the assumptions that are feeding into the model, as well as the data that's been used. But again, it's really applying the same principles, where it's likely that inspection is going to contribute greater reliability of evidence than inquiry. If you're just asking around, have there been any changes in the assumptions from 1 year to the next year, or in the previous version of the model, getting a verbal response to that needs to be seen to be at a lower level of reliability than if you actually look yourself and inspect. And hopefully these things are reasonably common sense, but it's helpful, I think, just to keep in mind the principles that we need to be applying, the concepts that we need to be embedding into the audit process and into our audit documentation, is just making sure that we are very mindful of the quantity and quality of audit evidence and some of the factors that can have an impact on our conclusions. So just to wrap up what's, you know, I think are really the key points here for us to be focused on in terms of audit evidence. We need to make sure that we can demonstrate that the quantity of audit evidence that we are obtaining and the procedures that we are designing in order to obtain those is reflective of the level of risk. You know, we don't just go through a risk assessment process and assess risk levels just for the sake of it. You know, it is there with the need to try and utilize that risk assessment to drive the quantity of audit evidence that we are seeking through the audit procedures. Quality of audit evidence, as I keep on saying, is really important, and this really just revolves around reliability and thinking about inquiry, thinking about statutory declarations, and thinking about the strength of the evidence that you can get from different sources and from inspection, and keeping that in mind because that's really highly influential in the quality of evidence that we are using. The right mindset, though, I think is is really an important aspect of this. It isn't just around looking for corroborative evidence. It's making sure that we are, you know, designing certain procedures that are going to help us to obtain just this balanced degree of audit evidence. And, you know, we're not there just to seek out evidence that purely supports what has been claimed or asserted, or whether there's been compliance or not. You know, we need to be making sure that we're embedding audit procedures that are there to look for things that may well be inconsistent. And as I say, in our audit documentation, it's very enlightening, I think, from looking at audit documentation as to how skeptical and how challenging has the audit been. When there's a good recognition of any of these limitations, any of the inconsistencies that we are seeing in the audit evidence gathering process, that they have been fully considered in arriving at our conclusions, and that we're not trying to avoid putting things like that on the audit file. If, you know, whatever we find, whatever the sources are, whatever the evidence is, acknowledging that and bringing that into our overall conclusions, and not trying to dismiss or downplay some of those limitations or inconsistencies. And the final point, which I probably don't need to repeat anymore, it's fairly self-explanatory, but it's, you know, as we know, the audit report is really where the rubber hits the road, and that's where the key deliverable and the output from the whole audit process. So just making sure that, you know, we are thinking about the evidence that we're gathering and what we're putting into Part B in the context of the overall opinion that we've given in Part A. So that was all I wanted to run through in terms of some of the technicalities, and hopefully some degree of the application of that in a couple of different scenarios. So happy to move into question time. Peter, have we had any questions being put in the chat? I haven't looked at anything.
Yes, David Wall's got a... interesting question. He says, it's always a challenge to document on the audit file the reasoning behind the poor reliability or lack of evidence. This shines a light on potential audit evidence failures and exposes the auditor to the quality control challenges by third parties. Do you have any thoughts on this challenge? Thank you, David, for coming up with a good question.
You know, many of you might have heard some sessions that I've delivered in the past, and I, you know, reflect on, you know, my journey as an auditor, and very much, going back a couple of decades, that you made sure that the audit file was as clean as it could be, and that there was a reluctance to put some of those question marks on the audit file. You know, I think that we are in a different place, and we need to be in a different place, and it's entirely appropriate that we are, that the audit process and auditors are being challenged about how skeptical are you really being? And the only response that, you know, I think one of the key responses to that is the open acknowledgement of inconsistencies, of issues, of lack of availability of evidence really demonstrates the rigor in which the audit has been conducted. And, you know, we talk about the auditor, you know, having to have a good sense and application of professional judgment. You know, that's where it becomes, you know, real. Here is all the evidence that I've gathered, whether it's good, bad, or indifferent, and I'm using my professional judgment to come up with what I believe is the right overall opinion. So I think in answering the question is, you know, I think we need to be far more transparent around all things that we find that constitute audit evidence and apply professional judgment in coming up to overall conclusions based on all of that that evidence.
All right, thank you, Julian. If anybody has any question, please feel free to unmute yourself and ask your question. Take advantage of Julian while he's here.
Julian, Dick here.
Hi.
Quick question. The process and the discussion we've had today and in previous sessions is all around, you know, more substantive type testing and work. Surely we should be now at the stage where many of our clients are they've got good systems in place for capturing the data, and we should be actually focusing more on internal control systems and basically internal controls. So it doesn't, I don't sort of see that language coming through in the training, but I think I would be sort of advocating sort of the larger organisations or the ones with significant volumes should actually be having that as a key goal, to be having proper systems and controls in place that we can actually test the controls rather than actually doing substantive testing all the time.
Absolutely good. Yeah, good point. And it wasn't one that I reflected on when I was going through here, is the extent to which audit evidence is coming from testing of controls and therefore reducing substantive evidence. But it's a very relevant concept, and the degree to which there's increasing maturity of our clients' systems and processes, and that they are becoming more and more reliable and they're effectively designed and they're operating, then yes, we should certainly be looking to try and source audit evidence from the effective operation of well-designed controls.
So I had one other question as well, Julian. Thank you. I agree, and I think we should be pushing for that, to be honest, because it's not a new thing this anymore. It's actually been in place for a while, as long as it's cost efficient, of course. The second one is always in regards to, you know, the guidance that's being done on extended external reporting. So I was wondering whether anything's coming through on that is going to impact on what we might be doing as our in our audit engagements over this extended external reporting, or any sort of nuances coming through from that work that we should be considering. That's the guidance on SA 3000.
Yeah, I'm very familiar with the extensive 200 plus page guidance that the IAASB have issued on extended external reporting. And I think it's, you know, it's a good question. It's not one that I can answer right here and now specifically in relation to audit evidence, but I agree that there's a lot in there, and the IAASB, you know, has really moved the dial forward in terms of guidance and support for the conduct of these engagements. So, you know, I think it will be, you know, potentially a healthy topic for another one of these webinars in the future, just to reflect on, you know, what's coming out from that guidance across all aspects, not just audit evidence, that really can help us to be informed and, you know, do a better job in auditing the, you know, this type of information.
I believe Nick has got his hand up. Did you have a question, Nick?
Got my hand up. It's a mistake. I don't think so. I know Paul Adams has put a comment, a question in. So.
Yes, we do have a question from Paul. Paul's asking, to what extent does audit evidence need to be directly retained on the audit file? For example, safeguard mechanism forecasts could be commercially sensitive, and also complex modelling, which is difficult or impossible to recreate without software. However, the auditor is often relying on these forecasts held at the client site. With digital data, it is more of a challenge, as the volume of audit evidence can be significant. What do you think, Julian?
That's not an easy one to answer. But it's, you know, it's very topical. There is a project in the works at the IAASB on audit evidence, and one of the topics that is the driver for that is around technological advancements and accessibility of electronic audit evidence. So, Paul, I appreciate the question, and it's a great question. I think that, yeah, other than just me reiterating what the auditing standards say about, you know, we need to make sure that the audit documentation keeps a good trail to support some of the significant judgments and conclusions, the specifics around, you know, how we deal with digital data and technology, I think is probably something that will emerge more over the coming years when we get more guidance from the standard setters. So I'm sorry I hadn't really answered your question, but it is a topical area that I think that does need more attention.
Thank you, Julian. Tom Young's come up with a question. What level of documentation on the audit file would you expect to see around why the level of evidence gathered is appropriate? As a simple example, the auditor may be able to justify, if queried, why looking at X invoices from Y sources is appropriate. But do you expect to see this logic documented proactively in the file, perhaps as part of the risk assessment and test planning phase? Thank you, Jim.
I think there's a lot that happens on the audit in terms of decisions and steps, and clearly not everything needs to be documented on the audit file. To the extent that I think they are, you would see them as being significant decisions, to the extent that an independent reviewer might question what you've done because it's not apparent, I think those would be the two principles that I'd be looking to try and apply in deciding, do I put this on the audit file or not? So firstly, if it's there and it's, in your view, a significant decision and highly relevant to the conduct of the audit, then I would say yes. Secondly, if I think that an independent reviewer might question why I'd made a particular decision and it's helpful for me to just put the rationale on the audit file anyway, just to you know, preempt any questions around why decisions have been made, I would also be inclined to put that on the audit file. So I think you know, the specifics here, you know, it's difficult to say yes or no to, other than just in the context of, if you think that it's fairly obvious why, if there's a firm's methodology that says this is the sample size is that we will select in certain circumstances, if you've got specific criteria that you're using to try and determine which are the higher risk invoices, then you know, I think that those are the things that I think, you know, sensibly would be on the file if you've determined some specific criteria yourself. But if there's a firm's methodology that you're just following, then I wouldn't say there's a need to specify that on the audit file. So hopefully that answers the question.
Thank you, Julian. David Wall had another question earlier, which I didn't get to. He's asked, any thoughts on the application of ASA 540, auditing accounting estimates, including fair value accounting estimates and related disclosures? This will require project proponents to be more responsible for the evidence they provide. Any thoughts on educating project proponents on these new requirements?
So the requirements of 540 are, you know, primarily in the context of financial reporting and accounting estimates associated with financial reporting, but the underlying principles, you know, are just highly relevant to any estimate. When I was talking about the forecasting model, trying to drill it down to what is the model that's been used, how. Where has it been sourced? Is it a bespoke model? Is it an off-the-shelf model? The key assumptions that are going into that model, and where have they come from, and who's prepared them, and what are the sources and reliability of the underlying data? You know, those are essentially the components of ASA 540 in terms of trying to get an assessment of the reliability of a forecast, which are just applicable to any estimate. So I think that the concepts should be embedded in the audit process. You know, that is an auditing standard that doesn't have any jurisdiction over the preparers of information or the entity themselves. But I think, you know, if I just boil it down to those basic principles and concepts, I think unless there is some rigor around the entity themselves being able to respond and provide evidence around why they've used this particular model, why they've chosen those assumptions, why that data is the right data and it's complete and accurate, you know, I think you'd struggle not to have some limitations on the audit evidence that you're gathering. So hopefully that's given some flavour to my thoughts on the topic of estimates.
Thank you. Did anybody have any other questions? The chat box is not showing anything, so that probably means we don't have any, but we'll give the people a few more minutes. It's an interesting area. Jen, there's one thing I was thinking about with stat digs. I guess it's really important to know the dating of the stat dig. And I guess related to that, if say you do a stat deck saying that yesterday I counted 100 cows in the paddock because it was only yesterday, you think that carries more weight. If you had a stat deck which said 2 years ago I counted 100 cows in the paddock, I guess that raises questions because 2 years is a fairly long time between events.
Yeah, absolutely. And whether the person giving the stat deck was actually there at the time, you know, whether they the person counting it, so there's a number of factors that are in there that you can just be contemplating when determining, well, you know, how much can I rely on this stat deck? As you say, yeah, time frame is an important element of that.
And I guess similar to that, if you had photographs of you counting those cows 2 years ago, then that would lend more support to that stat deck.
Yeah. And again, just reinforcing what I'm talking about this sort of mindset, and it's not just about getting evidence that supports what's there. You know, if somebody today is asked to prepare a statutory declaration and say these things, they're going to be asked to say the things that support what's there. They're not going to be asked to say things that are going to disagree. So, that's another important element, I think, about how much credibility you can place on a subsequently prepared stat deck. When really, is it going to be an unbiased piece of information? When the whole purpose potentially of the stat deck is just to be able to support what's been done. It's not to give an unbiased and objective opinion of evidence that might contradict.
Thank you. Now, we don't seem to have any more questions, but I would like to suggest to everybody, if you do have any questions that come to mind after this event, please feel free to contact the agency. We're always happy to talk to auditors and to answer any queries that you may have. Definitely, if you have a question, better to ask it than not ask it. And assuming we're not getting any more questions, I think that might be a wrap for the event. So I'd like to say thank you, Julian, for your wonderful presentation, and thank you everybody who's participated.